So I noticed that there are some classic films from my era about to show up on Netflix this month. Goodfellas, Donnie Brasco, The Shawshank Redemption, Outbreak, There Will Be Blood, and more, and it got me thinking. I am a movie freak, and I have found that engaging with many of you on social media, a lot of you are as well. I was thinking about the movies that I grew up with, the Star Wars and the Terminators and the Alien and Predators and all of those fucking films that I grew up with. I grew up believing were the greatest movies of all time. But you know what? Everybody grows up thinking that. No matter if your era was before ours or after, you grow up thinking your movies are the best of all time. And I remember the first time I ever saw One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest, and it changed my life. It was just a great movie, and it was the first time I really thought to myself, wow, there's a whole world of movies that I've kept myself from through sheer ignorance, and I can't allow that to happen. So at that point, I really started to dive into movies from before our time, you know, movies from back in the black and white age, and I've really found some gems along the way. And the reason we're going to do this little piece we're doing today about the 60s is because my favorite movie of all time was from the 60s, and it's number one on our list, of course. So this little PSA for all of you metalheads that are also film buffs like I am, here you go. 10 movies from the 60s that every motherfucker must see before you drop dead on this planet. Alright, that means since we're doing the 60s, we're diving right into the decade of peace, love, and Quaaludes, dude. The counterculture was on high, and the youth were all jacked up on LSD and protesting the war and the powers elite. While middle America gasped in horror at the levels of free love our teenagers were capable of, as well as the violence. And for all of the press the 60s got for being the decade of free love, it was also one of the most violent decades in our nation's history. Set in this backdrop, we're a number of young filmmakers looking to make their mark in the cinematic universe, and man, several of them did exactly that. Which is what brings us to this, the Crypt's list of 10 movies from the 60s that every human being must see before you die. First of all, let me start with my unpopular opinion. 2001, A Space Odyssey will not be on this list, and I fucking love Stanley Kubrick, and he will be represented on this list. I love a good slow burn, but 2001 was so fucking slow that it puts you to sleep in my opinion. I'm sorry, I know some of you are gonna hate me for this, and I'll give you, it was beautifully shot, and it's a movie you should probably see, but I didn't include it on my list because it's fucking goddamn snails on my dick slow. So let's get on with the fucking list of movies that you do need to see, starting with number 10, Easy Rider, 1969, directed by Dennis Hopper, written by Dennis Hopper, Peter Fonda, and Terry Southern. This movie also starred Hopper, Fonda, and one Jack Nicholson. Let's kick this thing off with a powerhouse. This movie is the cornerstone of counterculture flicks and has the pretty crazy distinction of being well known that all of the drug use in this movie was real drugs. That's right, no stunt double for these motherfuckers, man. They took one to the chin for the team. Touching on the hippie movement, drug use, and the communal lifestyle that was pervasive of the 60s, Easy Rider is a movie that stays with you. It portrays two bikers, Hopper and Fonda, traveling through the American Southwest on hogs and carrying the money they picked up from a big cocaine deal. The pair travel the roads and meet folks who tend to love them or hate them, but ultimately serves as a cautionary tale and shines a light on the fact that while most of middle America view the bikers and the hippies as the problem, many of them were much more violent and fucked up than even the drifters. A fact that holds true to this day, if you ask me. Number 9, Bonnie and Clyde, 1967, directed by Arthur Penn and starring Warren Beatty, Faye Dunaway, Michael J. Pollard, and Gene Hackman. Cool side note, this was Gene Hackman's first movie, and he would go on to rack up over 100 movie credits in his career. This one is an actual biopic and depicts the lives of the infamous Clyde Barrow of the Barrow Gang and his love interest Bonnie Parker of Texas, who he meets while trying to steal her mother's car. She decides to run away on a crime spree with him, and this true-life drama would be the basis for every story, real or imagined, of young, lustful, and violent couples forevermore, including, in his own words, Quentin Tarantino's take on Juliette Lewis and Woody Harrelson's characters in Pulp Fiction. Beatty and Dunaway are nothing short of fantastic in the title roles and deliver a story that you just can't miss. Plus, this movie may very well hold the distinction of having the most violent and bloody endings to any movie of the decade that wasn't an expressly gore-riddled horror fest. Number 8, The Birds, 1963, directed by Alfred Hitchcock, one of the greatest movie makers of all time, and this will not be his only appearance on this list. Starring Rod Taylor, Tippi Hedren, Jessica Tandy, Suzanne Pleshette, and Veronica Cartwright. Cool side note, this was Tippi Hedren's very first credit, and she would go on to have more than 80 film roles and is still alive and kicking and acting. How awesome is that? Based on the novel by Daphne du Maurier of the same name, The Birds is the story of a few days in Bodega Bay, California, where, without rhyme or reason, our feathered friends go on the attack. I love Hitchcock, and while this one has lost a little bit of luster over the years, it is certainly in need of a visual boost. But What Jaws did to every single person who got into the ocean for decades, this movie did to people just walking down the fucking street. Classic. Number 7, Dr. Strangelove, or How I Learned to Stop Worrying and Love the Bomb, 1964. Director, the great Stanley Kubrick. Starring the great Peter Sellers in multiple roles, plus George C. Scott, who is brilliant as always, Sterling Hayden, Keenan Wynn, and more. This 1964 black comedy is a twisted little peek into the minds of the men in the American war room during a crisis with Russia at the height of the Cold War fears and climate. It stands as the perfect parody for the time in which it was created and of the men who make decisions and mocks the piss out of them. Sellers plays President Muffley, the title character Strangelove, and not without its tongue-in-cheek poke at moviegoers, Lionel Mandrake, with other characters named Brigadier General Jack D. Ripper, Colonel Bat Guano, Major King Kong, and Russian Ambassador Alexei D. Sadisky. I think you are starting to get the flavor for this one. With an unflinching view of the absurdity of man, Dr. Strangelove is movie magic at its finest. There is simply no such thing as a movie fanatic who has not taken in this one. And for number 6, I cheated a little bit because I'm throwing 3 movies at you here, and that is the first 3 James Bond movies. Dr. No, 1962, From Russia with Love, 1963, both directed by Terrence Young, and Goldfinger, 1964, directed by Guy Hamilton, starring Sean Connery as the great title character. This, ladies and gentlemen, was the golden era of James Bond films. I am a fan of all of them, for the record, and I think I forgive even the bad ones because they are fucking James Bond movies, and because these 3 movies exist, and they are the first 3. Sean Connery was the best Bond for my money, gang, and he was the perfect combination of suave and badass. The Roger Craig, who I do like, don't get me wrong, but this generation of Bond fans have lost that. That cool as a cucumber way Connery played Bond was fucking brilliant and unparalleled. Plus, Dr. No gave us the gorgeous Ursula Andress as Honey Rider, a role so sexy and iconic that her poster from this movie adorned the walls of the entire nation's teenage boy population for a decade. And let's not forget that Honor Blackman had the coolest character name in the history of movies in Goldfinger. Pussy galore. Enough said. Go see these shits. Number 5, Butch Cassidy and the Sundance Kid, 1969. Directed by George Roy Hill, who is behind some of my favorite movies of all time. He not only directed this classic, he also did The Sting, which was another Robert Redford and Paul Newman vehicle, but he also did Slaughterhouse 5, which is a must-see movie. He was behind The World According to Garp as well, which is maybe my favorite tear-jerking comedy of all time with the late great Robin Williams. Butch Cassidy stars Robert Redford, Paul Newman, Catherine Ross, Strother Martin, and Jeff Corey. This is a western based extremely loosely on the real lives of outlaws Robert Leroy Parker, who you all may know as Butch Cassidy, and Harry Longaball, or the Sundance Kid, who are on the run from a posse of lawmen after they have gotten away with a string of train robberies. The film follows the pair, along with Sundance's lover, Etta Place, played by Ross, as they attempt to flee to Bolivia to escape persecution in Wyoming and renew their criminal activities. In the final scene that has been borrowed from so many times that it is somewhat tired in modern films, the balls to the wall ending of this one still holds the guts and glory of the best films and best film endings of all time. Go see it today. And here comes that Hitchcock fella again. Number 4, Psycho, 1960. Director, Alfred Hitchcock. Starring Anthony Perkins, Vera Miles, John Gavin, Martin Balsam, and one of the original Scream Queens, Janet Leigh. Mother to one, Jamie Lee Curtis. Speaking of which, see Knives Out immediately, people. That movie is fantastic. Countless spin-offs, parodies, and even a TV show centered around the origin story of the one and only Norman Bates has come along since the original classic, and while many are very good, none of them can quite capture the intrigue of this master applied burn that Hitchcock uses to unfold this tale into our laps. Norman Bates doesn't get quite enough love among the great movie murderers, in my opinion, and none of its peers, the Chainsaw series, the Friday the 13th series, or any of the other greats that get all of the attention can hold a candle to this one. With an early twisted take on everything we now take for granted about serial killers, from voyeurism to obsessions with one's mommy, this one broke all of that ground and then punched you in the face with it. While many claim to have seen the ending coming, who have seen it in its later years, that is only because the Hitchcockian approach has been so stolen since then. But let me tell you, moviegoers in the 60s, when the ending came to this one, their jaws had to be swept off of movie theater floors. Fucking gold. Number 3, Night of the Living Dead, 1968. The mother of all zombie flicks, and most people seem to have forgotten nowadays that this movie broke the mold in so many ways. This was the first major motion picture to be shot by a white director and to cast a black lead actor. This movie was written, directed, and and edited by the man, the legend, George A. Romero, with a co-writer credit going to his buddy John Russo. It was made on a budget of $114,000 and grossed $18 million internationally, more than 250 times its budget. This is a true cult classic in every sense of the phrase here, starring Dwayne Jones and Judith O'Day. The story follows seven people who are trapped in a farmhouse in Pennsylvania, being surrounded by a growing army of the undead, or zombies, giving us the classic line, "They're coming to get you, Barbara." This is an absolute must-watch flick for any serious horror and or film fans in general. Number 2, Rosemary's Baby, 1968, director Roman Polanski, starring Mia Farrow, John Cassavetes, Ruth Gordon, who I love from her role as Clint Eastwood's Ma in the movies Every Which Way But Loose and Any Which Way You Can. Right turn, Clyde. Anyway, Rosemary's Baby is an absolute classic. Based on the novel by Ira Levin, Roman Polanski both directed and wrote the screenplay for this psychological horror thriller. The film plays on the background themes of the late 60s, like the women's liberation movement, Christianity, and the cult. Rosemary, played by Mia Farrow, and her husband move to the Branford apartment building in New York City, where Guy, played by John Cassavetes, is trying to make it as an actor. After Guy gets his first big role due to an accident that causes the original actor to go blind, he and Rosemary decide that she should have a wee little baby. What follows is some demon dick, or some Bill Cosby devil donging, if you will, and from there the tension builds like a water bead on a knife's blade. This is a must-watch movie, and a generation of film enthusiasts will notice tons of themes that have been borrowed from Roman's work over the years. Crazy side note, Roman Polanski married Sharon Tate in January of 1968. Rosemary's Baby came out in October of 68, sometime during which he got his wife pregnant. And as you all sadly know by now, a pregnant Sharon Tate was one of the five people murdered at Polanski's Los Angeles home on August 9th, 1969, by cult leader Charles Manson's followers. And before we get to my number one movie of the 1960s that you must see before you die, here are five honorable mentions. The Planet of the Apes, 1968. The original Manchurian Candidate, 1962. The Time Machine, the original Time Machine, 1960. The Good, the Bad, and the Ugly, 1966. Clint Eastwood, the original Spaghetti Western. And 1962's The Man Who Shot Liberty Valance, James Stewart and John Wayne. And on to number one. And number one, and the reason we chose the 60s for this little list here, is Cool Hand Luke, 1967. Director Stuart Rosenberg, starring Paul Newman and George Kennedy and more. All right, now I could, and maybe someday I will, do a video on just prison movies, because it is almost its own genre at this point. And there have been some greats, too. Escape from Alcatraz, Brubaker, The Longest Yard, Stir Crazy, and of course Shawshank, that we already mentioned, is going to be on Netflix this month. But another great one is Bad Boys from 1983. Not the Will Smith Martin Lawrence vehicle, but rather the prison drama that starred a 23-year-old Sean Penn, who by then was playing his sixth role as a teenager after turning 18, including what might be my favorite role of his of all time when he was in Fast Times at Ridgemont High, a year before this one, by the way. Alright, I got a little sidetracked. Let's get back on track. Cool Hand Luke. This movie is widely hailed as an anti-establishment movie, being that it came out during the growing hippie movement and the subsequent anti-war sentiment that was growing across the country. Much like Easy Rider, and the running theme centers around the question of conforming to the system and falling in line or becoming one of the conformist sheep. Set in the 1950s, Paul Newman plays Cool Hand Lucas Luke Jackson, who is sentenced to 2 years in a prison Florida chain gang. Due to repeated run-ins with the guards and at first his fellow inmates, Lucas's individuality and resistance to conform to the rules makes him a character you can't help but root for, but also one that can't help but try to escape over and over again. This movie has laugh-out-loud moments and moments that will tug at your guts, and once you watch it will never leave you. Add in an outstanding and Oscar-winning performance from George Kennedy of Naked Gun Police Files fame as the jailhouse badass dragline, and this movie sets the bar for all prison flicks. Cool Hand Luke is sometimes credited with being the father of prison movies, which it is not, but when referred to as the best, I think that is spot on. And if you don't agree, I think we're having us a failure to communicate. That line, by the way, is listed as the American Film Institute's 11th most memorable movie line of all time. Plus, Cool Hand Luke has a perfect 100% rating on Rotten Tomatoes. Cool side note here. This might be Paul Newman's best role in a career that includes more than 80 films. Yeah, hear that again. Over 80 films. That is crazy. Cool Hand Luke ended up grabbing 4 Oscar nods. And if you think Newman's 80 film credits are impressive, when Kennedy passed away in 2016 at the age of 91, he had an unbelievable unbelievable 186 actor credits to his name. Wowzer. Make sure the Cool Hand Luke is at least one of them that you see before you die. And here you go. Those are your films of a great decade that you must put in your head before you leave this planet. Much love, much metal. This has been a Metal-O-Mania report from the Crypt.